Good evening. Welcome to the Wild Systems Sustainable Futures Discussion Panel. I am delighted to have each and every one of you here tonight, and I'm thrilled to be able to present to you the program that we have for tonight. So thank you so much for coming to this, for caring enough about the future, about the environment, and about climate change to be a part of this discussion, to witness it, and hopefully take part. My name is Amy Lewis. I am the Director of Partnership Development for the Wild Foundation, and I'll be your host this evening. My goal, though, is to let a rather improvisational and hopefully a little bit raucous conversation go on between our panelists. Just to let you know, a few years back, I went to a concert at Becher Hall for the world-renowned German cabaret singer Uta Limper. Uta was world-renowned, but she wasn't Denver-renowned, and so only about 50 people showed up to be a part of her performance. But she was incredibly gracious, and she invited us all to come closer to the stage. And so I am asking you now, I know that some of you may be shy, but I'm asking you now to get a little bit cozy, to get a little bit intimate, to get to know your neighbor a little bit better, and come down here to be closer to this conversation. While you're doing that, I might as well tell you, Uta had an ulterior motive. In her vampire impersonations, she decided that she was going to lunge into the audience and bite convenient necks. It's unlikely that I will be doing that tonight. I doubt our panelists will be, although I don't know, Mark Beckoff can really get off the hook sometimes. If you are courageous, come down to the first rows. There's reserved seating here. Ignore that. If you want to be in the front row, be in the front row. I promise Mark won't bite. This evening is brought to you by a very special partnership between the Wild Foundation and the International Society for Systems Sciences. And I'm going to let the president of that organization, John Kinneman, speak in just a second. But before I do that, I wanted to introduce you to the Wild Foundation and let you know what we're about and why we decided to be a part of this evening. For over 40 years, the Wild Foundation has been breaking down cultural and institutional barriers in order to unite science and culture behind an ethic of care for nature. We started in apartheid South Africa as a commitment between two friends, the game ranger Ian Player and his Zulu mentor Makubu Intembela, who through the strength of their friendship and their vision were able to bring the white rhino back from the brink of extinction. It's their vision that friendship, that relationships, are absolutely necessary to solving the biggest problems that we face. And they began the Wild Foundation in order to bring people closer together to solve the environmental problems and challenges that are so unfortunately prevalent around the world. Since they founded the Wild Foundation, we have been working to break down these barriers around the world. We've done so in the deserts of West Africa, where we've facilitated for the first time 8 ethnic groups coming together to jointly manage their natural resources, prevent the degradation of elephant habitat, and also help save one of the last remaining desert elephant herds from poaching. We're doing that in North America by bringing together the 7 agency heads of the North American land management agencies in order to elevate conservation to a continental scale for the first time. And we do that with our World Wilderness Congresses, which we host once every 4 years or so, to create a global agenda for wilderness and ecological protection that's non-binding, but that has done so much to advance wilderness in places and countries where they don't even have a word for wilderness in their language. Wild is so proud to be a part of this evening because of the diversity of the viewpoints represented on our panel. What you will witness tonight is a microcosm of the way Wild works, bringing together different groups of people with vastly different viewpoints, but to find common ground so that we may achieve a transformational vision of what our planet will look like in the future. Thank you so much for being a part of this evening and for helping us keep this planet wild. Now that we're all settled and that I've introduced Wild, I'd like to introduce John Kinnaman, the bold president of the International Society for Systems Sciences, whose vision and inspiration made this one-of-a-kind event and conversation possible. John is this evening's co-host and will share with us the occasion for this important event, as well as the crucial necessity that the system sciences will play in creating a sustainable future. John, would you?
Good evening. I don't have a great deal to say. We have our event taking place all week in Math 100 and the engineering building. The ISSS began in the 1950s by Ludwig von Bertalanffy, and also another person from CU, Kenneth Boulding, was involved. And the goal was to learn how to study nature and society from a different perspective than is common in the sciences, to look at it in terms of systems. We still struggle to understand what that means, but we know it means something, and we know it means something profound. And I think we now know, as we look at the global system and what's taking place, that it means something extremely important and relevant to modern times. So I want to express how happy I am, how honored, how pleased, and just in awe of Wild Foundation for pulling this together with these amazing people. I first encountered Wild in the Fourth World Wilderness Congress, and it took place in Estes Park. And I was so blown away by that meeting. In my entire career with the federal government and with the university, I've never been to a better run conference. They had a wonderful mix of scientific, technical information, PowerPoints, you know, and the next speaker would be a cultural representative, like a Zulu chief, and his talk consisted of giving all the sounds of the mating calls of all the animals in his country. And it was a wonderful blend, and at the same time, they had a policy session going where they could reach out to the world and say what's important about wilderness. And I've tried to model our conference at the ISSS on some of these ideas, and we also have a policy session. For the first time in 60 years of doing conferences, we will attempt to pull together some statements about systems and how important it is to learn how to think in terms of systems and apply that to our world so that we're not just managing parts, and so that we can realize that we have now reached a stage of global dominance where we are now in charge of this planet and its systems, whereas it ran itself for 4.5 billion years. And we don't have a manual and we don't have a guide. But anyway, let me stop there because we have much more interesting speakers. And let me again thank Amy Lewis and Wild Foundation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. We don't have a manual and we don't have a guide, but we do have each other. And I hope that we can rely on each other in the future to find the solutions that we need. Now, just to give you a little bit of a logistical briefing about what will happen tonight, we're going to have our panelists who are having a conversation about some pretty in-depth questions and some also some pretty broad questions. But my favorite part of the evening will be when the audience gets to participate. And so just to let you know, if you do have questions that you want to ask our panelists, about 8:40, we will be opening up this session for audience questions, and that will run for about 30 minutes until 9:10. There are two microphones along the aisles, about halfway down. that if you are interested in asking a question, I would ask that you line up at those microphones and pose your question. Because we'd like to get through as many audience questions as possible, please keep your questions to a minute at length. And other than that, let's just have some fun. So I am going to start by introducing our panelists and having them come out on stage one by one so that I can give you a little bit of their biographies. And I want to start with Dr. Joshua Tewksbury. Josh, will you please join me on stage? Dr. Tewksbury is the incoming Global Hub Director of Future Earth, a global research platform providing the knowledge and support to accelerate transformations to a sustainable world. Josh is an ecologist, conservation biologist, and planetary health scientist who bridges the gulf between academia and civil society. And Josh, did you tell me that you discovered the reason why chilies are hot?
Subject of another lecture.
Okay, so I will take that as a yes. Jeff Orlowski, will you please join us on stage while I lose the shoes? These are really uncomfortable. Okay. Jeff Orlowski. Mr. Orlowski is the director, producer, and cinematographer on the Sundance award-winning film, Chasing Ice. His documentaries have been invited to screen at the White House, the United Nations, and the United States Congress, and has captured over 40 awards from film festivals around the world. Chasing Ice went on to receive an Academy Award nomination for Best Original Song and has screened on all 7 continents. Impressive, even in Antarctica?
Yes, it is.
Oh, wow. So all of these gentlemen, by the way, have far more accomplishments than I'm reading to you now. This is just a brief little taste of what they've done. Mark Beckoff, please join us on the stage. Mark is a former professor of ecology and evolutionary biology at the University of Colorado Boulder. Dr. Beckoff is a fellow of the Animal Behavior Society and a past Guggenheim Fellow. In 2000, he was awarded the Exemplar Award from the Animal Behavior Society for major long-term contributions to the field of animal behavior. He and Jane Goodall co-founded the organization Ethologists for the Ethical Treatment of Animals in 2000. Mark's latest book is Rewilding Our Hearts, Building Pathways of Compassion and Coexistence. And I hope you can talk a little bit about that tonight, Mark. Alarion Merkuliev. Alarion was raised on St. Paul Island in the Bering Sea and is proud of his fully intact traditional upbringing. Alarion has over 40 years experience serving his people and other indigenous groups, locally, nationally, and internationally. Larry was the first Alaska Native Commissioner of the Alaska Department of Commerce and Economic Development and is now president of the Global Center for Indigenous Leadership and Lifeways. He has received numerous awards for his service, including a Buffett finalist for Indigenous Leadership. His most recent book is Wisdom Keeper, One Man's Journey to Honor the Untold History of the Unungan People. Did I say that right? Thank you. I'm practicing. And I know that I've already downloaded it from Amazon. I'm looking forward to reading it. It just came out July 19th. Bill Becker. Bill is an internationally recognized authority on energy and climate policy. Since 2007, he has been the executive director of the Presidential Climate Action Project, which develops recommendations for the President of the United States on how to move America to a clean energy economy and to greater climate stability. Thank you, Bill. John Fullerton. John is the founder and president of Capital Institute. He is the author of Regenerative Capitalism, How Universal Principles and Patterns Will Shape the New Economy, and a recognized thought leader on the future of capitalism. He is also an active impact investor through his Level 3 Capital Advisors, and previously he was a managing director of JP Morgan, where he managed multiple capital markets and derivative businesses around the globe. John is a full member of the Club of Rome and a director of the New Day Farms, Inc. and Savory Institute here in Boulder. Thank you for joining us, John. Gunter Pauli. Professor Pauli's entrepreneurial activities span business, culture, science, politics, and the environment. Under his leadership, Ecover pioneered an ecological factory in 1992, featured on CNN Primetime News. He also founded the Zero Emissions Research Initiative, ZERI, at the United Nations University in Tokyo. And I understand that the University of Pennsylvania has just named this the eighth most sustainable think tank in the world? Most innovative, thank you. So ZERI has just been named the eighth most innovative think tank in the world, and subsequently established the Global ZERI Network as a foundation, redesigning production and consumption into clusters of industries inspired by natural systems. These are our panelists. Will you please give them a warm welcome? And please have a seat.
We have one more panelist.
Oh, yes.
Hunter Lovins.
Okay, thank you.
There she is.
And because we love to be spontaneous here, Hunter Lovins, will you please join us on the stage? Bill, would you like to do this?
Sure. I wanted to apologize for Amy. We brought that extra chair out, and I'm sure she didn't know why, but we had a revolution in the back as we stood backstage that we are not a very diverse panel. So Hunter is one of the internationally known experts in this topic, co-author of Natural Capitalism, founder and president of Natural Capitalism Solutions here in the Boulder area, and she's brilliant, as you'll soon find out. Thanks, Amy.
Oh.
Sorry to stage revolution.
Thank you. I was about ready to apologize for the lack of gender diversity on this panel, so I now don't have to do that anymore because you guys were backstage burning bras. Thank you. Okay. So, with our panelists here, before we actually launch into the conversation, there's one more ritual I would like us to go through, and that is, don't worry, I'm not going to haze you. But that is, we have a distinguished leader in the indigenous community on our panel, and it is right and customary when receiving and giving between groups to offer a gift, a symbolic demonstration of a concept known as reciprocity, which we will be talking a little bit about tonight. And so I would like to honor all of my panelists and reverence them with this gift that we're about ready to present. Just as a token of our gratitude for your participation and a little way for us to give back for the energy that you're putting into this work. Thank you so much.
Is it alive?
And all of our panelists, except for Hunter, I'm sorry, are receiving Moonstone spheres. The Moonstone was chosen because it's associated with the moon and feminine wisdom, and it was my personal apology for not having found a female panelist for us tonight. That is now not needed anymore, but I'm happy to offer these to you all the same. Everyone except for Josh Tewksbury, who received Doctor Who cufflinks because he looks like a Time Lord. Okay, so on to our discussion. Before we actually start the conversation, I'd like to ask each of you individually to introduce yourselves. Talk a little bit about what brought you into sustainability to begin with, your own personal story, and address some specific questions about your past and the work you've done. So I would like to start first with John Fullerton, actually. John, are you ready? John has last year came out with a paper called Regenerative Capitalism, which is really an in-depth look at the differences between economic and financial systems and how an economic system could be harnessed to create transformative change in our economy. John, I'd like to talk to you a little bit. I'd like you to talk a little bit about the role of capitalism in sustainability. After the 2008 financial crisis, not a lot of people would want to defend it, but you wrote this incredible white paper that is one of the best defenses I've seen. Would you please talk a little bit about regenerative capitalism?
Sure, and I'm not sure I'd consider it a defense of capitalism. It's a pretty harsh critique of capitalism, actually. But the idea of that really germinated from years of studying system science, and it really probably started when I read Limits to Growth for the first time after I left my job on Wall Street and started to learn about things that truly mattered. And it pretty much freaked me out, to be honest, because as a finance guy, understanding that the economic system was the root cause of the ecosystem crises, and that understanding very well that finance is what drives economies, it became very clear to me that the root cause of many of our ecological crises is actually rooted in finance and people like me. So I got to work thinking about that in a fairly deep way, and the paper is essentially a synthesis of what a lot of people that have been studying system science for decades, if not longer, have been writing about and saying and synthesized in a way that made sense to me. So if you're interested in it, capitalinstitute.org is where you can find it. It's called Regenerative Capitalism: How Universal Principles and Patterns Will Shape the New Economy.
Thank you, John. Professor Pauly, would you please talk a little bit about the role of business in sustainability and your work in that sphere? I mean, it's closely related to the economic and financial work that John Fullerton does, but there's overlap and then there's completely different aspects of it. So how are you harnessing business and entrepreneurial endeavors to create a more sustainable world?
Well, first of all, thank you for having me. And let me just say that the only way you turn towards, I would say, fundamentalism in sustainability is that you go through a hard experience. I mean, in life we learn when things are going very tough. And these tough moments in life have to be a source for inspiration and a source for gathering a better understanding of who am I and what can I do. And so my very tough experience was that when I thought, even I thought, and other people thought that I was a guru of the green business by having created this ecological factory that was making biodegradable detergents, I had to learn the hard way by being in Indonesia and being celebrated as the biggest buyer in Indonesia at the time of palm oil that actually I was destroying the rainforest and destroying the habitat of the orangutan. And so that experience just woke me up. But that experience woke me up at the same time I was having my first two sons. And you know, it's on one hand this celebration of opening the first ecological factory in the world, on the other hand celebrating the fact of having two boys coming to this world, which you think are yours. And then having to make a decision, what am I going to do as the person who did not see the difference between biodegradability and sustainability? I think this is one of the biggest problems we have in business, is we don't distinguish some of these concepts. And even today, biodegradability is very different when you put it in water, in the sun, or in the soil. And we just have no clue how this actually works. And still, we have all these campaigns by corporations as this is biodegradable. What we need is true sustainability, but true sustainability can only happen if you have ethics at the core. And how do I find the ethics at the core? Very simple, that when my sons were 2 and 3 years old and I realized that I was destroying the rainforest, I had to ask myself the question, am I now going to do less bad, reducing my footprint, reducing carbon emission, or am I going to harness my intellectual and business capacity to create more good? And at that the difference, there is only one big difference, is what is your ethical principles about business? And the ethical principles of business really grounded in me when I asked myself the questions, how would my son look at me in 25 years' time, and he happens to sit in the audience there, Lawrence Frederick, how is my son looking at me in 25 years' time when I would have made the decision to continue with the business, to destroy a little bit less forest and to get a kind of a sustainability certification from some organization that I've paid very well, like Unilever does and others do? And how would they look at me when I have taken that route? Or how would they look at me when I say, I can't continue, I have to change the business model fundamentally? And that is only by answering the question, how will my son look at me in 25 years' time? And that is how I started looking at business very different. And I never looked back since. Thank you.
Thank you, Gunther. Your comments about the ethics of sustainability are interesting, and I think they overlap with something that, with some observations that one of our other panelists have made, and that would be Ilarion Merkuliev. Ilarion, you have an interesting story about sustainability as it's perceived in dominant mainstream culture, and you also have interesting contrasting viewpoints that come from the native perspective.
That's a song called Spirit Crying and Grieving and Spirit Singing. It's the cry of Mother Earth for her children. It is not her crying for herself, because she will go on. And it's a question of whether or not we will go on. And she sees us suffering to try to decide what it is we're to do. And I'm just reflecting what she feels. The elders that I work with all over the world are speaking with some urgency now that I've never heard them talk about before. And they are saying that we must change our consciousness now. That this, we must shift from the consciousness of the mind to the consciousness of the heart. That logic and rational thinking is not going to get us out of this mess. Only from the heart. And what we choose to focus on becomes our reality. That if we choose to focus on that which we're reacting to, compared to what we want, that will become our reality. That if we put our emotional, our physical, our spiritual energy into reacting, then we are going to feed that very thing that we're reacting to. I mean, it's been proven time and time again. You look at the environmental groups in the world. There are more people, heartfelt, that are trying to help Mother Earth now than there were 30 years ago, all over the world. But yet, Mother's life support systems for us are being pushed to the edge. Why? The elders say that the reason is we're choosing to invest ourselves in what is what we consider wrong, rather than focusing on that which we feel needs to be done. Yes, they said we should step in and say stop something if we feel it's wrong, but do not invest our energies in that reaction. Invest it in that which you want to make. And it's going to take being in the present moment and in the heart. That, you know, we left the present moment when we engaged in guilt, shame, remorse, anger, rage, jealousy, all these kinds of things, or fear, which is projection into the future of something that hasn't happened. Every place except now. And now, you know, the great thinker, who is that? I'm thinking about, who is it? It's not Eisen.
Just call him the great thinker.
No, he's really Einstein.
Einstein.
He said, we cannot solve the problems by the same consciousness that created the problems. And that's exactly what we're doing in thinking about what we're to do. Because we're schooled from the get-go, from childhood on up, to listen to the adults, listen to authority, and listen to what we are to learn, how we're to learn it, and all these things defined by adults other than ourselves. And we take that all the way to postdoctorate degree. And that's anathema. It is a death knell for the human race unless we act and wake up now. So, and it takes courage to jump, to go into the heart and pay attention to that rather than paying attention to what's in the mind. Yupik elders in Alaska, they call this reverse society, where we reverse all the laws for living. And one of those reversals is the mind now tells the heart what to do, what it used to be, the heart telling the mind what to do.
Thank you, Larian. Mark, you have some things to say about the heart.
I do.
I'm pretty sure you did, at least a few minutes ago.
At least a few minutes ago. Is this on?
Yes.
Yes, thank you. You're a hard act to follow. But I'm basically here to represent the non-human animals in the equation, because, also known as animals, but because they seem to be left out of, I mean, virtually all discussions, really. I always seem like I'm popping in and putting us, you know, like something in the spokes of a tire or of a wheel to stop the discussion. But so that's one reason, and I've been playing around with an idea that I call rewilding sustainability, and that is, once again, playing off of a recent book of mine called Rewilding Our Hearts. And when I first met Larian a few months ago, we were talking, and then we realized we had nothing to say to one another because we basically agreed. But I do agree with him. I'm a scientist, and I'm just going to throw out a couple of things, and maybe it'll generate some questions or discussion. First of all, I don't think we need any more science to act. I mean, I like science, and we collect a lot of data, but we don't need any more science to know that we're destroying the Earth and focusing on the non-human animals, we're plummeting. I mean, we're just destroying them in an era that people call the Anthropocene or the age of humanity, and I call it the rage of inhumanity, because that's really what it is. I mean, there's unprecedented losses of species. And just for example, some of the egregious things. Today, I posted an essay about some South Pacific islands are feeding dingoes with poison capsules, 1080. They're going to release these dingoes on an island to kill invasive goats. And then if the people doing this, they are humans, but it's hard to see them as human beings. If they can't shoot the dingoes, then these are time capsules. And so the 1080 that the dingoes have ingested will kill them. So this could be one of the sickest things I've seen. I mean, there's sickness in agricultural food systems and other aspects of science. So that's basically what I'm really interested in. I don't think we could go on and have an integrated or a coherent world if we don't factor non-humans in. And that will require a change in heart. So the notion of rewilding our hearts came from the conservation idea about rewilding, and that was originally a movement to build corridors, mainly for carnivores, actually, so that they could move over overpasses, underpasses, and they could move unimpeded by human beings. And so what came to me once was that the notion of rewilding could also involve building corridors in our body, and that's where I did not know about Ilarian's work, but it's really having the heart motivate the action rather than vice versa. And it then leads to compassion and empathy and sympathy and all those sorts of fluffy boulder type things, basically motivating us. It would involve rewilding media. Non-humans are continually misrepresented via media. It would involve rewilding classrooms and education. And actually, imagine getting kids outside. I mean, seriously, there's so many programs now that have been canceled because somebody might get their dress dirty or their shirt dirty, or they may fall, and then the teachers will pay the price for it. It also involves, I have what I call the 10 P's of rewilding, but the most important would be being proactive, that we can't continue putting out fires, being positive. Negativity is just an energy and a time suck. We just really gotta get beyond that. So when people go, oh, how bad things are. Yeah, things are not very good, but we can all find ways to improve, and that's what everybody on this panel is doing, is trying to improve the world for others. Being passionate is just getting people to pursue their passions and their dreams and not worry about what other people think about whether their dreams are fluffy or whether they seem to be unimaginable. So I like to think about the unthinkable and imagine the unimaginable as we move ahead. So that's basically why I'm here.
Thank you, Mark. And what I'm hearing with part of this rewilding discourse that you're inventing, in the process of inventing and writing about, is this idea that we're not separate from the natural world, and that we need to bring the outside in and the inside out. And this gets to something that I think that Bill has addressed in the past, the idea of the myth of separation. Bill, would you talk a little bit about the myth of separation and how you came to recognize that that was in fact a myth?
Amy challenged us to get personal, and so I'm gonna tell a story I've never told in public before, and kind of an embarrassing one in a way. I didn't go to college, I went to Vietnam. And when I got back, I lived with a woman who was a meditator. I had never meditated in my life. We went on a picnic one day in the woods, and she disappeared. And after a while, I went to find her, and I came upon her meditating in the woods, and I could feel this incredible silence, this incredible peace coming from her. And I thought, this is something I want to try to do. And the next day, I went home, and for the very first time, I tried to meditate. Something happened, I'm not sure what. I lost about 20 minutes. And I came to, and I didn't know what had happened. The next day, I remembered that I had walked down a tunnel, and this is one of those life-after-death experiences, walked down the tunnel and came to a huge, white, sun-like orb. In that orb, I felt perfect wisdom, perfect love, and infinite, those things infinitely. That wrecked the rest of my life. Because ever since then, I've been searching for a world that reflects those things. My story is, the rest of my story is rather superficial compared to what you've heard, but after Vietnam, I went out and farmed in southwest Wisconsin, this beautiful, hilly, primitive area that had been missed by the glaciers, to try to heal up a bit. And we did yoga in the woods, and we grew our own food. And after about a year of this, I was feeling a little better. I bought a newspaper in a neighboring town. And this town was flooded. Every 10 years or so, they had a massive flood, and the people would just hose down the muck and shovel it out and go back in and live right back in the path of this river again, the Kickapoo River. The Army Corps of Engineers, when I was there, when I first came to this village, was trying to talk the people into building an earthen levee around the village to protect it from this river. And they wanted to spend $3.5 million to protect $1.5 million worth of property. We didn't think that was really smart. And as we were leaving the meeting with the Corps of Engineers, one of the local bar owners said to me, you know, we ought to just pick this town up and move it out of here. We laughed. And 3 o'clock the next morning, I woke up and said, or thought, that's precisely what we ought to do. So I ran back to my newspaper office and I wrote a report to the Corps of Engineers saying, give us the money to move. We'll never bother the federal government again for disaster assistance. And instead of forcing the river to adjust, we'll adjust. We'll let the river be a river, and we'll move the town and get out of its way. Well, the Corps didn't want to do that, but the short story is, over the course of the next 8 years, we moved the town to higher ground. And this was at the end of the 70s, so in the process, because of the Arab oil embargoes, solar was kind of a cool thing in those days, and the farmers in this community, the shopkeepers, decided they wanted to be the first solar town in the United States. So we built the town to be 75% passive solar heated, which in Wisconsin was a neat thing. The myth of separation comes from that early experience. I really think, as I peel back the layers of all of this, that where we go wrong and where we can go right is to get rid of this myth of separation, that we're superior to, more intelligent than, can control these natural systems, that somehow we're separate from them, and we're not, obviously. And that's, to me, what needs to be fixed. If people had that consciousness, I think the world would be quite a different place than it is today. So in a way, from the outside, from the mundane working inward through policy with the president and stuff like that, all I'm trying to do is recreate that feeling in the world. And like I say, it wrecked the rest of my life. But I've been very lucky, and it's my mission.
Thank you, Bill, very much. Jeff, you come to the whole sustainability and environmental discourse from a completely different gateway, and that's through storytelling. Would you please tell us a little bit about that and about how you came to make Chasing Ice?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Mark and I have an interesting overlap in that we're both friends with Jane Goodall, and I got to know Jane when I was a senior in high school, and quite honestly, Jane changed the trajectory of my life. It was getting to see and hear her lecture regularly that kind of put this impression in the back of my mind of what was going on. And when I was in college, I sort of left the environmental world and started studying film. And then many of you know the local photographer, James Balog, and we had an opportunity, I had an opportunity to travel with him and started following him all around the planet. We went to Iceland and Greenland and Alaska, and we were documenting what this team was trying to do in trying to see and visualize what was happening to glaciers. So long story short, we made a film, Chasing Ice, and the intention wasn't for it to be an environmental advocacy piece. It was really just to showcase, this is what this team did, and it was awesome and fun. And we kind of were blown away by the impact that has had, and for me personally, I've just fallen in love with the power of film as a medium to tell stories, to show evidence, and to to relate to an audience. It's a lot of what we're talking about right now in terms of that disconnect between the heart and the brain. We can think, we can rationalize, we can understand the science on climate change, but do you feel it? Does an audience feel it? Do skeptics feel it? I once made a slide for a presentation, and it had on one side there was a chart, and on the other side there was a video. And the video was of a lion charging towards the camera, and on the other side was a chart with distance and time and, you know, possibility of something bad happening, and you could see the line and the trajectory, and this is where we were, and this was the forward projection. And which one is going to make a more meaningful impression? Which one is going to hit you immediately? You don't need to look at the chart and study it to know what the visual is telling you. And so what we have been trying to do, our team has been trying to do in the film space, has been how do we communicate climate change visually? How do you get people, how do you get audiences who might be skeptical to understand what's going on and to feel it emotionally? And if we can take what we know and what we can understand and what we can interpret from the science, and if we can somehow figure out how to make that emotionally resonant and emotionally engaging, then I think we've succeeded. And so that's what our team has been working on.
Thank you. Josh Tewksbury. So as a scientist and as the leader of, one of the leaders of this global initiative to kind of bring science together and achieve, collaborate and achieve collective impact, what do you think the connection is here between the heart and the brain, and how does science play into that?
So I think I'd like to start by saying just a quick poll. How many people here have been through an institution of higher learning? Yeah, that's kind of what I thought. So, so a little thought experiment. I think if you took someone from about 1890 and you had a time machine and you dropped them into today's society, I believe there's only one institution they'd recognize, and it's the one we're in right now. This is the institution of the way in which we do higher education, the way in which we do training in science hasn't really changed much since we started doing that in order to feed the Industrial Revolution. The world has moved into a very different place, and our institutions, this type of institution, has not sufficiently tracked that change. So I didn't realize that when I was an undergraduate at funky liberal arts college, and I didn't realize that when I started running around South America trying to chase chilies. Science is an incredibly addicting passion. It can consume you like any other passion. And I was fully consumed, but I got into that space very much to create a better future, very much to be a part of that future, that creation of a better future. And it wasn't until I got through, the sort of 5-10 years in, was a tenured professor and all of that stuff, and then I realized that this process that I'm engaged in isn't sufficient to create the change that we're confronting globally around the world. That we have a huge sector of society that's really not pulling its weight sufficiently to have an impact, to have the impact that we need to make it through this sort of next 25 years. And I started looking at that next 25 years, and I said, well, that's about the amount of time I've got left. And so I can find hotter chilies, or I can figure out a little bit more why they're hot. And I love natural history, and I could do that till I die. Or I could do something a little different and step out of that game slightly and try to see how you can reinvent it, how you can support a reinvention of some of the aspects. What I don't want to say is that science isn't relevant, because I think it's fundamentally relevant. It's where we and if you sort of question that, I mean, you know, many we all owe a lot of what we're doing right now and our livelihoods to sort of some fundamental invention by people who didn't have that much consideration for the future of the world necessarily. But there's a huge host of individuals in science that don't feel like they have an avenue to have impact. And if we squander that talent, we are losing out on a potential for much more rapid change than we're allowing to happen right now. This is a time in which I think all sectors of society have to sort of step up. We don't have that much opportunity. And that gap is closing. And so science has to sort of take a step change in its impact. Future Earth is an attempt to work with scientific communities around the world to do that. When my I grew up on a farm in Vermont, and I just recently came back from putting the ashes into the ground of my mother and father just earlier this week. Just flew here from there. When my mother and father passed away, one of the things I remembered about them was that, you know, they were Hollywood people, and I never saw Hollywood because they just kind of tossed in the Emmys and all that stuff and went to Vermont to become farmers, because I think they reached a point in their life when they were saying, what do I want to do with my one wild and precious life, as Mary Oliver would say, or any other sort of framing of that question. What is it that I can do with what I bring to the world that can create the kind of impact personally, professionally, globally, locally, that I can feel proud of, that I can pass on? And that's, I think, where I am at, and where I think there are more and more people who are feeling a little bit trapped in their space and want to have impact with their work and are tremendously talented. And I think we owe it to those people to make it as easy as possible for them to have impact. That's what Future Earth is really trying to do, is create that kind of impact, focus global scientific inquiry on the questions that society is demanding answers to be able to make real progress against the major goals that we face. And that's where we are. I'll stop there.
You started by talking about time machines. I knew you were a time lord. So if science isn't enough to do this alone, Hunter, would you please tell us, explain a little bit more about what you were saying about backstage? We have all the technology we need to do this. What's stopping us, Hunter?
Story. And we've said it in many different ways. We have no idea what it would be to win. We're real good at what it would be to lose. And all of us can cite the statistics of how many parts per million CO2 in the atmosphere, or the latest catastrophe, or the latest nasty news, or the latest zombie movie. All of our story is about apocalypse. It's about dying badly. What would it be to win? What would be, Bucky Fuller said, we need to create a world that works for 100% of humanity. What is that? John Fullerton's paper, Regenerative Capitalism, is the best I've found in 40 years of working, trying to come up with solutions. And John and I argue a bunch, and we're going to get together tomorrow and argue over a book that I'm working on now, well, he and I are working on, and a bunch of other people from the Club of Rome, looking at, can humanity avoid total system collapse? And the Club of Rome, half of them said, no. I said, guys, first of all, you cannot take $100,000 from a foundation, turn around, tell them we're fucked. Bad tactic if you ever want to go back for more money. Second of all, I don't think it's intellectually honest, because we do have all the technologies we need to solve all these problems. What we haven't done is pull them together in a new narrative. And John calls it a regenerative economy. I call it an economy in service to life. But what are those parts? We're in a horse race with catastrophe, no kidding. This is one of those no kidding moments. And we could lose. I mean, horse races, somebody wins, somebody loses. The good news, I think, is we're in the race. The bad news is, y'all know. So what are we going to do about it? Gunter said you don't want to be less bad. Our movement, if you could call it that, those of us who care about a positive future, are a bucket of crabs. You know, you go fishing for crabs, throw them all in a bucket to take them home to boil them to death, and one of them starts to crawl out. All the rest claw him down. Less bad is good. It's just not good enough. And sustainability. Sustainability is only getting our nose above water. The great architect Bill Reed said nature is sustainable not because it's set out to be, but because it's regenerative. And so one of the things that John has been helping me to do, and a lot of other people, is delve deeply into what does it mean to be regenerative of human and natural capital, as well as manufactured and financial capital. Money and stuff is useful. We all like it. It's insufficient to build a finer future. So there's a team of, initially there were four of us, and then John and some others joined us, and it became about 8-10 of us, and last May in New York, it was 80 of us from 13 countries, trying to build a new narrative, particularly to counter the neoliberal narrative that now runs the planet. And it's heartening in a way that 36 men got together in 1947 at a hotel outside Montreux, Switzerland, and built the intellectual foundations that now run the planet. And roughly in 1980, with the election in this country of Reagan, in the UK of Margaret Thatcher, and then 10 years later or so, the fall of the Berlin Wall, they won. And this mental model that people are greedy, all you want is money, that is the only measure of success, that's who you are as a human being. Do you believe that? If you do, you'd never have children. If you have what the economists would tell you is a sensible discount rate, you'd never have children. So obviously we're not economically rational, and we do care about things that are more than money. And the best now of the behavioral scientists are telling us humans are at heart caring and cooperative, and we're at our best when we work together, when we are all in it together. This is not part of the narrative that if you've had Econ 101, you have been taught the Milton Friedman narrative. Friedman was one of those 36 men. So in a way, to me, it's heartening that a small group of people can build a narrative and the whole world ultimately salutes. What we've got to do is build a better narrative. We have the challenge now to build a finer future.
Thank you, Hunter. I would like to throw the next question out to the entire panel, and if you don't mind, piggyback on some of the things you just said. What particularly stood out to me was the notion of an economy for life. And
economy in service to life.
Economy in service to life. And I want to know what that would look like, and I'm certain that everybody has slightly different views of that. So, we already have this perfect, precious, wild planet that's regenerative, that does it all without us, and we've just been intervening. So how do we mesh an economy with that? How much of that precious, regenerative wilderness do we preserve, and how much do we continue to interfere? And what are the next steps to creating an economy in harmony with the planet versus in disharmony? Bill, would you like to start?
Yeah, a couple things. First of all, I wanted to point out that Hunter and I have talked a lot about all of this stuff, and one night over whiskey, I think it was, we came to the quintessential message. If we insist on ruining the planet, we have to stop calling ourselves the most intelligent species. Right, Hunter? I wanted to pick up on what she said about...
If we insist on ruining the planet, we're going to have to stop claiming we're a superior species.
Yeah. Same kind of thing, yeah. You say it your way, I'll say it mine. Wanted to build on what Hunter said about Bucky Fuller and about the fact that we see so much dystopia and apocalypse in our media, and we seem to be fascinated with that. I don't know why. But back before Rio Plus 20, if you remember that in Rio de Janeiro, it was the 20th anniversary of the Earth Summit. The United Nations was planning the largest conference it ever had organized, but it lacked a motto, I guess, or a theme. And a friend of mine told me about this and introduced me to the communications person, and we suggested that the theme be the future we want. The idea being, as Bucky Fuller said, we're here to be the architects of the future, not its victims. So what if people started talking about the future we want? Well, it went all the way up to the Secretary General, and they loved it, and it became the theme of Rio Plus 20. And the exercise, as we approached that event, was to invite the whole world to send us their ideas, visual ideas, drawings, videos of the future they wanted. And I guess I would say the first step to building the kind of economy that Hunter described is to begin envisioning the future we want from our hearts and our minds,
What would it look like? What would it feel like? How would we treat one another? I'll say one final thing. It used to be when we had an environmental crisis, it was pretty local, a river burning in, what was it, Cincinnati, Cleveland, and we could fix it locally. We used to think that the nature could pretty much absorb any punishment we gave it because it seemed not to complain too much. That's no longer the case, obviously. And when we talk about unifying and relating to one another in an economy of life, the world is teaching us this if we only listen. We now have a global economy. We have environmental problems where if I pollute, it's everybody's problem, not just mine. We have the possibility of pandemics on the negative side, but we have a world economy, we have a world energy economy, and over again, we have a world food crisis possible. The point is that we are learning in hard, cold facts that the world is one thing, that we are all related to one another. And so this myth of separation I mentioned before extends not just to nature, it extends to one another. We have the capability, too, of destroying all life. So that's what we have to learn. We have to learn what the future is we want. We have to envision it, work for it. We have to understand the unity that surrounds us all.
I just want to pick up on that slightly and just sort of think about you know, this idea of visioning and sustainability in a global level. And it's sometimes actually, I'm going to move here next week, and I will say that it's actually hard to think global from this community because it can take you away from almost any sorrows. It's so gorgeous, and you know, I feel like I have to, you know, run a marathon before I can even buy a house here. But
there's some of us who don't run.
Thank you. I was getting a little bit self-conscious. I think actually, you know, one of the thought experiments I think is very worth having at this point is to think about, to recognize that, you know, a vision of the world that includes things like the Brexit, that includes an isolationist community, countries going on their own, is a world where these problems don't get solved. And it's not just, it doesn't actually affect us here that much, but it has massive impacts of like on world health, for example. Countries that can't work together can't solve pandemics. And then you will have, you know, these pandemics spreading and many lives lost, and those then have a spreading effect and a further isolationist effect. And so one of the things I also wanted to pick up on is this idea that, you know, individuals, I mean, sometimes individuals are selfish. There's very good research on that. That's okay. I just look at my kids and it's fine. But groups that work together are more successful. And that altruism is also sort of seen in society. So sort of at home, one of the things that I think is really interesting for a country like ours is to think about the links between inequality and its ability to, and our globe and globalization, and how these two things aren't unrelated, and where our societies come together as a nation and we have more equal distribution, we have a much better chance of working in a more altruistic fashion with other nations. It's much easier to get caught up in what the Joneses have when there's large differences between different families than and it's harder to work together around major global goals. So sometimes I think our problems are both national and international and we can't separate the two. And I guess the other thing is that the sustainability crisis is a political crisis as well. And how we behave as a country is probably more important than the kind of light bulbs we use or where we buy our food per se. It's this working together. And the last thing is that 2015 and 2016 was this time of massive global sustainability goals that we have not seen previously. And it's this tremendous ground up opportunity. It's very differently framed in the Sustainable Development Goals and in the COP21. The climate action we have now, the Sustainable Development Goals we have now are very much countries saying, bottom up. We need to figure this out as a community, not top down, we're gonna tell you how to be sustainable. That's a hugely empowering space for communities to work together. And I think a lot of us are still trying to figure out how do we get our own communities out there reaching out with other communities to be more effective in this new bottom-up space. So super hopeful and helpful, but it's also a very, there's a lot of trepidation in that space.
John, you wrote a lot about inequality in regenerative capitalism. Would you share some of the insights from that?
Sure, and I'd like to build on what's just been said, which I agree with all of it except for some things Hunter said, which were extremely
bad.
Of course. But before I get to the inequality, the idea of heart and story, I'm completely on board with, and one of our core work streams at Capital Institute is a storytelling effort we call our field guide, so I'm fully on board and heart-driven, absolutely. But I want to defend our human intelligence, too, for a minute. And another interpretation of Einstein's quote was not that we need a new, different kind of consciousness, but that the problems that we've created can't be solved with the same type of thinking. And I don't know which of the two he really said. I've read it both ways, but I believe in addition to shifting from purely head to heart, we actually need to change the way we think. We need to shift from the 500 years of reductionist thinking since the Enlightenment to, and I can say this because we're in Boulder, holistic thinking. And actually, holistic thinking means something. And it's profoundly different than reductionist thinking. And another one of Einstein's quotes that I love to use is, he says, theory determines what we're able to see. And so getting to how do we get out of this mess and how do we make tangible progress, I think we need, and if one accepts my premise, which is that economics and finance are certainly A, if not the root cause of this, you could probably argue that human behavior is, but human behavior driven by neoliberal economic thinking, we need a new theory. And the value of a theory is we can see things differently. And let me give a tangible example. You know, everyone knows that corporations have this problem of short-termism, and everything's about quarterly earnings, and how can we possibly transition business models to long-term thinking when we're absorbed in short-term speculation and short-term thinking. So we've spent 25 years improving the transparency of the externalities, which is a non-meaningful word if one thinks holistically. And of course, we've made progress, but the situation is worse. If one has a set of principles, a theory that has a set of principles, it gives you a roadmap to think about where to find the root causes. And in the issue of short-termism in corporate behavior, there's a very clear issue, which is that through the efficiency of capital markets and our false pursuit of efficiency because we're working on the wrong theory, we've separated owners from companies. You know, a company that trades in the public markets literally doesn't have an owner. It has shareholders that trade in and out of the shares, but there's no owner the way there is that you own your home or someone owns a private company. And so you can't make the long-term decisions and the transformational changes like you made in your business if there's no owner. So if you simply had a little roadmap that said, principle number one, right relationship between owner and company, you'd have a place to start. We would have saved 25 years in dealing with sustainability in corporate, big corporations. So then, anyway, getting back to the point of inequality, it's another principle. One of the principles of living systems is empowered participation. You've got a wounded foot. If your blood doesn't circulate down to your foot, and your foot doesn't have the ability to participate in the oxygen circulating in your body, you're going to be walking around in red sandals the rest of your life, and you're not going to be able to be healthy and go to South Africa where you're heading next week in shoes. So the point is that if your toes, your feet, aren't empowered to participate in the circulation of your body, your toes fall off, your foot falls off, you're not healthy, your whole system is not healthy. The same applies to economies. So this inequality issue is not just a moral issue, which it is a moral issue, but it's also a systematic health issue. And again, if we had principles that we understood, we would look to inequality as it is, which is a sickness that's undermining the health of the entire system.
Okay. I'll stop there. Oh, thank you. I want to touch on the empowered participation aspect of this and ask Mark and Ilarion maybe to talk a little bit about what empowered participation would look from your point of view. Given that you, Mark, see yourself as a voice for the non-human animal world, and Ilarion's people are dealing with the brunt of the climate crisis. So if you could both talk to that a little bit.
Oh, God. Yeah, let me think. Well, I mean, part of the empowered participation would be bringing in the non-human animals. I mean, there's a lot of data now conservation psychologists are collecting on how we form different attitudes and beliefs about non-human animals and how that improves our well-being and how we connect to natural environments and how when we feel connected to them, we feel better about ourselves. So that would be one thing that I might, you know, bring in. I mean, you know, I kind of sit here and so I never, to the best of my knowledge, if I had a course in economics, I failed it. But
that's good.
Which is probably good. No, I realized when I said that would be an A. But a lot of what I hear, and I may be wrong, and I think what I love about these panels is you can just be honest and come across as dumb, but a lot of what I hear from, my dad was a businessman, and if he ever heard me pondering business, he would just, he'd roll over, really. But it sounds like a lot of this discourse is very Western. It just, I mean, it may not be, but it just seems, it's just very Western. I'm not saying that it's intentionally ignoring, but it seems to put aside 99% of the world who are not empowered. You know, I mean, everybody probably on this panel and many people in this audience have traveled widely, and, you know, you just meet people who are just trying to make a, you know, a living. I remember going into a school in southern Kenya where there were 30 students and one pencil. I mean, literally. So I left 5 Bic pens, and I mean, they don't think about Santa Claus there, but that's how I felt, okay? And it's a story that I always tell because it was powerful. I do a lot of work in China, and I've been to India, and you just see these people. So that would be empowered participation, bringing in non-humans, and bringing in the people who get screwed by Western values and our systems. Because at least what I read, and I don't know if it's really true, but it's the poorer people in the world who really suffer at the hands of the rich, if you will. So that would be something that I would kind of bring in.
Yeah, the elders that I work with, they always talk about root causes. That if you don't come to the root cause of something, you will not come to the answers. And the root causes for things are very important. For example, in terms of empowerment of people, the world's educational system and the way that adults raise children are geared towards that, taking that child's authority away from them. It's not self-empowering. And the child thinks that that's the way everything is run, and so we see it from throughout the educational system and in Western society, certainly in many other places in the world where we've got postdoctorate and anything less than that is considered inferior. And that we have learned to give away our authority to that person who is supposedly the expert. And the elders are saying during this time, we are all experts. We are all the gurus, and there's no one who isn't a guru during this time, and that we must look to ourselves for the answers. And when you look at yourself, it makes an importance of whether or not you begin with the heart rather than the mind. The heart will tell the mind what they need to do, and not the other way around. And that's when you come from the heart. I was raised in a traditional way. My generation was the last generation that had a fully intact traditional upbringing. The adult's responsibility was to simply create the space for the child to learn, not tell them what they should learn, how they should learn, or explain anything. I grew up not asking a single question. I had to figure it out for myself. And the ingenuity of that is that you can expand to the maximum of your ability without prescription or abiding by adults. And we are, and the view is that we are all spirit beings in human form, and that we are caretakers of the child for a period of time. They're not our children, they're spirit beings. in physical form that, yes, were born in our family, but they have their own sacred journey, and that we must not interfere with that sacred journey. And we interfere with it by taking away power, personal power, by traumatizing the child, by exposing them to things that any child shouldn't be exposed to, especially in the imbalanced world like these elections, for example. We're going through a national election process, and it's one-upmanship, it's competition, it's dissing the other, and we have national leaders talking about killing openly. Now, what example does that set for the younger generation? They are going to grow up believing in those principles. And we have, when we talk about studies, we don't need to study the world. We need to study ourselves.
I would argue we need to study both. And there are movements now trying to transform education. I helped create a couple of MBA programs in which sustainability and regenerative principles are baked into every class. And I say to my students, if any of us were any damn good, we'd have solved these problems. So for the next 2 years, you're my students. After that, you're my colleagues. Let's start that relationship now. If I say something and you think it's wrong, please tell me. You could well be right. And let's co-create answers. And that creates a very different classroom. And this is a Master's of Business Administration. And yes, we teach economics, but we don't teach the Milton Friedman variety except as a critique of it. We teach regenerative economics and finance and all of the business verticals. And you know, as you were saying, the science is critically important and understanding things. My friend Janine Benyus and I were sitting having whiskey a couple months ago, and she was all excited about the wood wide web, the fact that the mycorrhizal fungi are all talking. And I was excited about this new economic narrative, and we realized they're flip sides of the coin, that the same misinterpretation of Darwin, that life is only about competition and only the strongest survive, that's not what Darwin said. So we need history as well. We need to understand what these theorists actually said. And we also need to listen to the previously disempowered voices. They've been surviving on the edges of our economy, and they know a lot about how to survive when things are tough. And sometimes just shutting up and listening to them might be the best way to do the best science.
I just chime in there to say that I think one of the ways of rethinking the science enterprise is to think of science as service, the same way a lot of other aspects. I mean, if you think of yourself as a service industry, it changes what you how you conceptualize the problems you face and the work you do in your daily lives. And I think the difference between the challenges and the solutions, a lot of scientists would say, well, there's a challenge and there's a solution, and what we need in the center is science. And that's true, but not sufficient. And what we really need in the center is service from a whole bunch of different parts of society that are working together to get to that solution space. Because the challenge part and the solutions part are actually not that hard to visualize. I completely agree with this panel that the narratives for those solutions are not nearly often enough taught. Diana Meadows had a great article on this ages ago, you know, and the art of visioning, of creating a vision for the future you want to live in. We rarely practice that art, certainly not in my field. And it's often looked down on to be a little too fluffy to sort of start talking about the future without knowing how you're going to get there. We need to be a little bit more exposed so we can do that without giving and still be confident as scientists who are rigorous and using all the best parts of science and falsification to actually create some grounding in how we actually move forward. But that doesn't get in the way of being of working in teams, of working with non-scientists, of co-creating with societal partners, of thinking yourself as just like any other service industry, trying to help build a little bit better of a world out there. And that, I think, is where science is headed. And I agree, there are some great, exciting things moving that direction. But for my taste, it's still a little bit slow.
But do you think science, I mean, it just seems to me that
maybe I should ask a question. I don't think our future depends on more science, though. I mean, I think the science is great. I love doing my science. But we have so much right now. And so what I hear from people is, well, the scientists say we need more science, so come back when you have the science. And I'm thinking, but we do have the science right now to make passionate, heartfelt, future-looking decisions. And that's what I find really disturbing, is that we do know enough that there's climate change. I mean, in my field, we know non-human animals suffer. We know they have a wide range of emotions, for example. But then we get into these, you know, pissing matches, and, you know, it gets down to the point where people who are skeptical or uncertain, or people who you're asking to make large changes in lifestyle say, well, come back to me when you scientists have the answer.
So let me just respond to that briefly, which is to say that I think you don't have to pit science against other aspects of society. In other words, let's just take any heart, like an issue such as, well, we want to have enough food for 7 to 9 billion people, we want enough water for that, we want to solve climate change. Well, the 2.4 degree solution for climate change involves, you know, currently the scenario for getting there, you know, a massive increase in biofuels, which wipes out a whole bunch of biodiversity. We need to figure out how to get to that point. That's where I think the science is important. It's a different kind of science. It's not just one discipline, but you do have to get different people working in a room to get the details correctly so you can set a chart.
But how do you translate those down to the everyday on the ground folks who you're trying to change?
That's his job.
No, that's communication.
Jeff Bolowski's job. Well, Jeff, how do you
spend a lot of time, an inordinate amount of time interviewing scientists and talking with scientists, and I hear very much what both of you are saying, but I think there is a middle ground. Like, we have the science that we need to make progress, but we still need a lot more science to understand a lot of the other factors on the planet. So there's an infinite amount of learning and growth we still culturally, collectively need to accomplish, but we have more than enough to make massive, massive amounts of progress. In my mind, one of the big things that we're sort of skirting around are different audiences and who are we talking to. And the conversation that we're having here in this room is a very different type of conversation than we would have in many other parts of the United States alone. And quite honestly, at least based on my travels and kind of study of the subject, the United States, we're sort of lagging behind everybody in regards to awareness on this. Really, when we look at our films and what we're trying to make and convey to an audience, we spend a lot of time thinking about who is the target audience. And honestly, the next film we're working on, I hope everybody here would enjoy it, but you're not the target audience. The target audience is how do you affect middle America? If you're familiar with the Six Americas language, there's a framework around where Americans and other countries fall on climate change specifically, and we are targeting the middle groups that are disengaged or doubtful about climate change. And that's where we believe we're going to have the most ability to have impact with the work. So how do we take the science that is known already, and how do we visualize it? And our job is to serve as a translator for the scientific community. The scientific community is not well-versed at communicating to the public. It is a system that's been designed around publishing papers, getting peer-reviewed, and getting recognized, and 1,000 people read your paper, and that's how you get to the next level in your career. And the field of science isn't and hasn't been well-adapted, especially with climate science. If you are debating astrophysics, the fundamental, you know, conclusions of your research don't have the same level of implications on humanity as climate science does. And it's been this very, very interesting niche of the field of science that has massive, massive implications on what those conclusions are. So what we're trying to do is help be that bridge for the existing knowledge base that the scientific community has and getting the general public to wake up to it. And I think if you're not tuned into those different audiences and what those different messages are for different audiences, then we're sort of just running in a circle and not taking that next step forward.
I want to bring...
Okay, well, before
intervene
here, how much knowledge is going to be enough? I mean, we're the most knowledge-born population in the world than we have ever been throughout human history. All of human history, and yet things are going to hell in the handbasket. Why? And the one of the things about science, for example, is that it lacks humility. For example, you ask a scientist, what is the most abundant marine organism in the world, in the world's ocean? Can anyone answer? It's not an IQ test.
Plankton.
That's the usual answer. And what it really is sea viruses. There are a billion sea viruses in a single teaspoon. But yet, we ignore that, because in the U.S. there's one scientist that's studying sea viruses. And that may be, in fact, the most important organism, but we don't know. Well, that's the point, is that we don't know, and we never will know, and that we have to act on what we feel now. And we have to act in an enlightened fashion, not in a haphazard fashion. And the only thing that guides us impeccably is our hearts. They're, our minds, they fool us, they deceive us, they do all kinds of things. And you can't, and when you're in doubt, you're in the mind. But the place that is not doubt, doesn't have doubt, and knows, is the heart, because that is the transformer from the divine to the physical.
Could I bring Gunter into this conversation right now? Because I think that you haven't had a manual, and you're an entrepreneur. That's the definition. You don't have a manual that you're operating from. You are innovating. You are coming up with solutions on the fly. And so you've asked the question before that we all need to answer, how much is enough? Would you answer a variation on that and talk about how much knowledge is enough before you can act?
You know, we don't have knowledge. We have data. And we don't even know what to do with the data. If I ask you, do you know the law of gravity? Everyone will say, I know the law of gravity. You want to Google the law of gravity? Google the law of gravity. You will find millions of sites that explain me how the apple comes down from the tree. But just ask the question, how did the apple get up in the tree before it could ever subject itself to the law of gravity? Not even Google can answer that. So, we've gone terribly wrong. I mean, because if you don't know how the apple gets up, what's the use of knowing how it comes down? And this is how we are today treating knowledge. I mean, I remember in 1978 when I was for the first time meeting in Brazil in Rio de Janeiro with Paulo Freire. And Paulo Freire could teach people in 2 weeks' time to read and write. In 2 weeks! I mean, I didn't consider myself extremely smart, but not that dumb that I needed 9 months. So what was wrong? How come we continue to teach children the same way we've been teaching before, although everyone knows that there are millions of people in favelas who learned how to read and write in 2 weeks? Because they followed what they needed, what their passion was, what their urge was, what their needs were. And this is where we're going absolutely wrong. We're sitting so stuck in our conceived, preconceived ideas, and we're not willing to let go, especially you in America and we in Europe. I mean, especially us. These white guys, they're exaggerating all the time. Ladies are the exception. You know, but we have to wake up to that reality, and therefore I think one of the greatest changes for this vision of the earth that we need is in the first place realize we know nothing. Absolutely nothing about real life. Second, what we realize is that our role as beings here is to inspire people to discover the incredible possibilities on this earth. I mean, talking about animals, I mean, the greatest for me is, of course, the whale, because the whale is able to pump 1,000 liters with 6-fold direct current for 80 years without maintenance. That's interesting. And it doesn't have a battery. No backup, no wires, no nothing. It runs. Why? Because it just has the right choice of food and has been designed actually to perform in an incredible way. So if you as a child listen to the story of the whale that is able to pump 1,000 liters with 6-fold DC, then if the dad were an engineer and knows about pumping, his conclusion has to be, that doesn't work. That's not possible. And this is true, in our artificial world, that is not possible. And that is why we're in desperate need to come to a rediscovery of what is really there. And that is what we have to do with nature. Nature, we have gotten this incredible idea. We have to preserve it. No, nature has to be put back on its evolutionary path freely, as much as possible without our intervention. But we have to be inspired by that nature, because that nature doesn't only have no waste, it has also no unemployment. Everyone always contributes to the best of their capabilities. What a nice principle. Why don't we do that? And I believe that, therefore, the greatest transformation we need in ourselves is that we all have to become teachers and students. And we all have to wake up the child in us. If we're not waking the child in us, then we can't be able to do this incredible discovery. I mean, when my daughter is in Zimbabwe, and she works with women who are surviving on less than a dollar a day, and she explains to them that on the coffee farm, with the waste of the coffee that is not commercialized, they can actually grow mushrooms, and the waste of the substrate from these mushrooms that can be used to feed the chickens. These women, they listen to her for 15 minutes, they get up, they sing, they dance, and they do it. You know what we do in Western Europe and America? We want business plans, Excel spreadsheets, technology audits, pilot projects. We are sick and tired of seeing all these pilot projects everywhere. We gotta stop doing. We have to do. I mean, we have completely dissociated not only heart and mind, we have dissociated from passion and action. We're not acting anymore. Everything is calculated and done. And we don't even do it when it's on the back of an envelope, something we can really do. And that is where I believe I spend 50% of my time as teacher. I think the most important role we have in life is try to be a teacher. But what kind of a teacher? I mean, my exams are very unique exams. I always get in trouble in any university where I'm teaching because I don't follow the rules of the game.
And 1 minute from now, we'll be in that part of the program. So if you will please just be patient for one more minute, then we'll get to audience questions.
No, if that is the reaction from an individual, please take the floor. Please go ahead. Don't be frustrated. Thank you.
Please go ahead. I'm finished.
We'll take audience questions now. Thank you very much. Sir, the sir who's been waiting patiently at the microphone.
Can I finish what I do with my exams?
Please.
Also from that individual who disagrees. Können Sie bitte mal einverstanden sein mit was ich sage, oder muss ich jetzt mal aufhören? Thank you. Herzlichen Dank dafür. Herzlichen Dank. My exams is an exam system whereby the students ask me questions. I don't have questions for the students. The students ask me questions. And that's the only way I can learn from my students. I cannot be sitting there and listening to 300 students repeating what I know. How boring. I can sit there for 300 students and listening to the incredible questions they have for me. And if I don't have an answer, they get maximum of the points. Thank you.
I'd like to open up the floor to questions now. Please.
These are four suggestions, and I would like to hear the panel's views on whether they would be interested in doing these things. I should say that my audience is generally the people who drink with me in my local alehouse, and they voted to leave Europe. So my first question is, would you be willing to give up pets, that is to say companion animals? I think that's the thing that most people could do very easily and would make a great contribution. My second question is, would you be willing to give up private gardens? So I'm happy to have gardens as long as they're community gardens. So the direct question to you, would you be willing to give up private gardens? My third question is, would you be willing to get rid of residential homes for the elderly and other people who need caring full time? And my final suggestion is, that the United States should close all the churches and open a lot more pubs.
Hear, hear to the fourth one.
So I would be willing to do the first three. I think there are some constitutional problems with the last one.
But the first three I think we could do. I could do. I would probably have to also give up my married life for one of them, but I'm not going to say which one.
Anyone else?
I couldn't give up my dog. Give up my dog.
Yeah, I mean, that's an interesting question. I mean, I work with a woman named Jessica Pierce, who's recently written a book called Run, Spot, Run, The Ethics of Pet Keeping. And so there's a whole debate in the animal protection community, of course, about whether we should have pets or companion animals. And I think it's an interesting, you know, sort of question to throw around, but I don't really see, number one, that it's going to be doable, and number two, I just don't see where it really gets us. I mean, I just don't. I mean, I just think that companion animals are part of our life, and asking people to give up an animal, non-human animal, who's become part of their life, I think is ridiculous. And from a real practical point of view, like I'd like to close all zoos, and I'd like to see zoos turn into sanctuaries, but let's be real. I mean, what are you going to do with the residents of the zoos right now? So I think it's an interesting question, but I honestly don't see where giving up companion animals has anything to do with the questions or what we're talking about now. Pubs, on the other hand, I think we should keep.
Okay, next question, please.
Over there.
Thank you. You've talked a lot about economics and science and covered a huge range, and I've really enjoyed the contributions, thank you. But one of the biggest questions in my mind at the moment, following the UK developments regarding Brexit, is changing the political system. And you talked in your introductions about leadership. And I just, if you could change one thing about our political systems, what would it be?
Mandate registration and voting. And pay for the kind of conversation before the voting that, for example, they do a lot of in Sweden, where in every community, the government will put a question and say, in a year's time, in 2 years' time, we're going to have a vote on it. But until then, we're going to have conversations in every community on an ongoing basis about it. So that by the time you get around to voting, people actually know what they're voting about. I was in London for the evening of Brexit. We were partying at Frontline Club, fully confident that it was going to fail, because that's what the polls were saying. Went to bed in Europe and woke up in a whole different country. And afterwards, a lot of people said, wait, I voted for what? Yes. They had no understanding of it. And you talk to a lot of people in this country who are partisans of one or another of the candidates, and they have no idea what their candidate is actually standing for. A famous experiment where people went around and read some of Obama's statements to people and said, Mr. Trump said this, do you agree? Oh, yes, absolutely. And they had no idea who had said it. We're politically ignorant as much as we are ignorant in a whole number of other arrays. So I would mandate registration and mandate that you vote, unless you have a real legitimate reason why not. The day of the election should be a national holiday, and make sure that people are educated on the topics before they vote.
I agree with Hunter. I would add something, though, not only to change the process, but somehow to change people's interest in the country and commitment to making it better. I think it's really interesting, the protest vote we've seen in the primaries on both sides. But is really the way to be, to protest against things being stagnant and you wanting things to change, to elect Donald Trump? I mean, yeah, there's, will they take any change is going to do? There's been polls now for many, many years, for example, in my field, where the American people say they want renewable energy, they prefer it over fossil energy. About 75% of the people say that. They want more research, they want more government involvement, in terms of funding renewables. But that's not what we see happening in Washington. There's an incredible gap between what the American people say they want and what the politicians in Washington are giving them. And that's because the politicians in Washington aren't run by the people. They're run by the special interests. And this seems trite, but it's true. And if the American people engaged and used the power of the vote and really wanted to make this country better and took the trouble to do that, we would have a revolution in the way business is done in this country, and we need it.
Next question, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Louis Klein. I come from Berlin, European School of Governance. There's this word that Bill Clinton said to Bush when he took over office. It's the economy, stupid. And for our debate here, and that builds on what the lady just asked, I would say it's the governance, stupid. It's not about the science, and it's not about the individual that has to change. It's not about the technology that we have available. It's about how we govern ourselves. We rarely look into politics, and we think, and that's probably one thing that comes as a question to you, how do we overcome this misinterpretation from the Enlightenment that self-organization is a good thing? When Adam Smith brought forward the metaphor of the invisible hand, he said, on markets, we have an equilibrium, a balance, that comes together as if an invisible hand was at work. And for that time, there was no question that an invisible hand can only be the benevolent hand of God. But we, as system scientists, have learned that emergence can go either way. Emergence and self-organization as such is not a good thing per se. It can create a catastrophe. It can create the very opposite of what was intended. And in our Western society, building on the Enlightenment, we still believe that self-organization is a good thing. And because it's such a good thing, that everything beyond the individual, we can leave to self-organization because it's good, and we are not responsible for that because that takes care of itself. So that's at the very heart of our economy and our politics, democratism as well as capitalism. And now the question is to the panel, how do we overcome that distortion in the reception of the Enlightenment? And how can we cater for spirituality beyond the individual? Because that's the other shortcoming of the Enlightenment, that we lay it all on the individual. If the voters were only smarter, if the consumers were only smarter, it's always the individual that has to save the day. So what concepts do we have for spirituality that reaches beyond the individual responsibility?
Please.
Thank you.
Can I take that? Yeah. That was a great question, and I agree completely in terms of this being a governmental problem to a very large degree. At least within the realm of climate change, which is where I can talk from, when this became a first realized issue, it came from Al Gore announcing it to the world, and it came with this message of we need to regulate this thing, and ultimately at a very fundamental level it became a partisan issue, just because there's a party that does not believe in regulation hands down, and so clearly this must be some conspiracy or something like that. And that story has been propagated, and it's kind of, we've been stuck with that. And climate change has turned into this partisan issue where there's a pretty clear divided line on the two sides of the aisle. I firmly believe that that's going to change. It is inevitable because the science is so overwhelming, and there are Republicans who are aware of the reality of the science. If you're familiar with the story of Bob Inglis, who is a congressman from South Carolina, a very conservative congressman, he was skeptical of climate change, and he was up for re-election, and his kids said to him one day, "Dad, we're not going to vote for you unless you change your stance on climate change." That was a big eye-opening moment for him. And he had an opportunity to go to Antarctica. He went down there. He went to the Great Barrier Reef. And he started to see what was happening to the planet. And he had his own awakening and transformation on the reality of this issue. He had that personal experience, that emotional, heartfelt connection to the planet in a way he was awakened. And there are a number of Republicans in Washington that get it, but they're afraid of what might happen to them if they speak out. Bob Inglis' story is this one of transformation, but it's also a scary proposition for Republicans, because when Bob Inglis spoke out about climate change and he tried to raise the alarms, the Tea Party ran an opponent against him and he lost his seat and he hasn't been back in Congress since then. And so there's this warning sign that if a Republican changes a stance, you might lose your job. And so we're going through this shift right now, and I firmly believe that this mindset is happening, and we're starting to see this, where the Republican Party is on this verge, and we'll see what happens through this election, but on the verge of being able to embrace climate solutions and to embrace it through the principles of conservatism. The answers are all there. We know how we can do it in a very positive way. We just need to make that shift. So one of the things that we did with Chasing Ice, every Q&A we would do, people would ask, what can I do? What can I do about climate change? And if you live in Boulder, if you already have solar panels in your house, like a lot of people are already aware of what they can do and have done those things. But ultimately, we always felt the thing that needed to happen the most was to shift politics. And how do you get people to shift politics? Like, how do we shift politicians on the issue? It seemed so overwhelming and impossible. I think many of us in the environmental sphere just write it off. It's so impossible. We're never going to get there. That why even bother? But what we wanted to do, what we tried to do, was instead of thinking broad and wide across the entire country and tell everybody to write to their representative and it's a drop in the water all spread out, we tried to focus on one individual, and we went to one congressional district where there was one particular moderate Republican who hadn't said anything about climate change in several years, and the last thing that he said was that he didn't think there was a scientific consensus. And we took Chasing Ice and we saturated his district. We screened everywhere we possibly could, and not for the green pieces and NRDCs and Sierra clubs. We were screening for hunters and fishermen and Boy Scouts, and Sierra, who works with Wild, was out there with us in Central Ohio for 3 months. We just moved our whole team out there, and we bombarded this guy with messages of the principles of peace and nonviolence. We weren't trying to attack him. We weren't trying to ridicule him. We had his constituents represent their messages from their heart on why we needed to do this for the right reasons. In 6 weeks, he acknowledged that climate change was real. Like, that's all it took. And thank you. And it was a focused effort trying to move one person from an emotional place, from the people that mattered to him and his constituents. And even though he is funded in part by the fossil fuel industry, this was a step, a drop in the bucket towards that right path. From our perspective, if that's an idea that we want to push out into the world, and if we can scale that, if we can spread it, if we can take those similar messages and get them to a lot of other parts of the United States that need to hear that message, we can shift our government perspective. All you need is a tipping point. And so that's what we spend a lot of time thinking about. How do you get to that tipping point?
Well, Al Gore's team invited me to be part of his team. And I said, well, sure, can I bring the Native American viewpoint? And they said, no, we got to use Al Gore's PowerPoint. And that, his, you know, Inconvenient Truth, the movie, contains a very dangerous subscript. And that is, you know, let's depend on all these technologies and things like that we can do to affect climate change. But he will never mention, nor will any politician mention, simplify. And that's one of the things that we must do now, is simplify our economics, our political system, our everything that we do, how we live. I mean, the houses we live in are really huge. You look at the average flat in Europe, they're 800 square feet. And here it's 2,000 plus, you know. That's just one thing out of many that we cannot address every single issue, but we can address whether or not we can inspire people to move to the heart, and then let that tell the mind what to do.
The one thing I would add to that is that, you know, we're also doing this at a global scale. And the governance issue is when we think of it that way as well, one of the narratives, the traditional Western narrative that we went through was we would, you know, we develop as fast as possible and maximize our GDP and then clean up the mess afterward. And every country that has done that has had, it costs more and more to clean up that mess. And it goes up exponentially. And so right now we're actually on a global scale asking for development pathways that are fundamentally new, that we haven't done. And so that's also, I think, when you think about this governance issue, at a national level, there's one shift, and I'd say for the Sustainable Development Goals, the richest nations have to move the fastest. But part of that movement is recognizing that these are universal goals, and in order to get there, nations have to skip fundamental processes that led us to where we are, and we have to redefine what success looks like. And it can't be what we are necessarily. You certainly can't use the same pathway to get there. And that's a fundamental reality, but also deeply troubling to those people who are trying to move up in the world.
Okay, I'd like to go to the next question. Thank you.
Hi. I'm a lot of things. I'm a human. I'm a mother. I'm a woman. And I'm a stylist, which has a lot to do with my question. I seek out academic experiences. And I'm lucky enough that my sister is Amy Lewis, so I got to come to this tonight. But most people that I have intimate relationships all day long, every day when I'm at work, don't think like me. So how are you going to expose the layman, not the government, but the layman, to this information without, like, and it's not going to happen through bureaucratic agencies being created. It has to happen through private, like agencies like WILD. But not everyone is going to, you know, pay $20 to come see this really awesome, interesting topic talk because they don't. They're more concerned on an individual level, and they have to be grabbed individually before it can come like this macro, macrocidal humility that we need. So how do you reach people like me who aren't academic?
You talk to the people that you interact with on a daily basis, and you tell them the stories that matter to you about these topics. Talking matters. Social media matters. We each of us have now, well, hell, this little device has more computing power than took a man to the moon. And with it, I can reach anyone on the planet if I want to put my mind to it and use it. Every day, find someone that you haven't had a conversation with about whatever it is that you care about, whether it be WILD or animals or early childhood education or entrepreneurship or the climate, and have a conversation with them. Set that as your practice, your spiritual discipline, if you will. I'm a fine one to be talking about spirit. But do that as what you promise to do every day, and I guarantee you, you will make a difference.
I want to elaborate on what Hunter said. I do this. I try to communicate this impenetrable science to people who vote and who should care. And I think there are a couple things I've learned. One is speak in the value system of this person you're speaking to. Don't try to convert them to your religion. People have their own religions. But understand where they're coming from, where their values are. Now, there are people who are so adamant, I don't want to say stupid, but people who are so caught up in their own echo chamber and so afraid of this issue that you will not persuade them, and I wouldn't waste the time, frankly. But when you see someone who is willing to talk about this, talk in their value system, the second thing is show them how this science relates to their personal lives. And it does. I mean, if there's one attribute about climate change that's really promising, it's that it affects everything. Everything we do in our lives. And we're seeing it manifest more and more and more in terms of extreme weather events, and heat and all that kind of thing. But one of my pet peeves, I'll just say and then I'll stop, is these ranking polls that give the politicians comfort because climate and energy come in last. On the 20 issues that the pollsters ask them about, they're always last. What people don't understand is that climate and energy affect the issues at the top in very intimate and profound ways. That you can't have a good economy, you can't have equality, You can't have national security even with the climate going the direction it's going. So somehow relate to people's values, relate this science or this understanding of climate change to their personal lives.
Let me tell a quick story on Bill, why talking matters. We were together in Paris, and I was talking with Dr. John Holdren, presidential science advisor, one of the smartest men on the planet. This was Tuesday of the last week, and John Kerry was running around saying, we can't have a binding agreement. And I said to John, why not? And he said, well, the U.S. Senate, and any treaty would have to go to the U.S. Senate. I said, have you not read Bill Becker's stuff? Bill ran the Presidential Climate Action Project, which ran through, there were about 200 of us that put together a whole manual on what the executive could do, just as the executive. And John said, no, I haven't seen it. It's like, wow. And he said, send it to me. I said, I'll do better than that. I'll get you with Bill. And Rand got Bill and put Bill and John together. And the next morning, Kerry was talking about a binding agreement. So it matters that you talk to people.
Next question, please.
Thanks so much. This is incredible, very, very thought-provoking panel. My question has to do with a lot of the social science research that's come up that suggests that in order to have effective action, you have to have a combination of essentially mind and heart, of these two things to really to make action possible. And the first mind is actually, I have to read because I always get nervous. The first thing is really the cognitive realm, which includes mind and intellect and reasoning and analysis, and is often communicated through text and numbers and pie charts and bar graphs, among other things. And the second thing is affect, which is the world of the heart, the emotions, feelings, values, attitudes, and beliefs. And that's often communicated through images and metaphors and storytelling. The arts have been valued for centuries for their affective power to move people, both emotionally and physically, to do things they otherwise would not consider or reflect upon, or have the interest, the energy, the courage, or the endurance to do. To what extent have you, all of you, except not Jeff, and probably not Ilarion, I don't know, worked with the arts as allies to help people, inspire people to make the shift that we all need to make?
That's a great question. I'll jump on it. The first thing I did when I started Capital Institute was to create a visual image with an artist. And if you go to our website, you'll see it. It's this bizarre looking thing, which is an abstracted hand holding an earth. And we use a lot of other visual work in our storytelling. And I couldn't agree more that, you know, we're not going to logic our way out of this. We're going to need to inspire people through the arts.
So I would just chime in. When I took this role at Future Earth, I also became an executive editor of a magazine. And I don't know that much about running a magazine, but I know the importance of communication. And I don't think the science is going to have the impact it needs to have unless you're also speaking directly through narrative, through great story, to people around the world who are going to be affected, not by great scientists, but by great writers, and by great visual artists, and by great podcasters, and by, you know, really working with media experts. And I think about what changes me. And it is almost always something of that nature. It is almost always in the art space that is the interpretation of, you know, something that may be, that is based in evidence, based in science, and that's because of my training, but it's the arts interpretation that gives it the power and the heart. So 100% agree with you. And I don't know if Max Boykoff is here, but he's here at the University of Colorado doing a phenomenal thing with climate and theater that is a similar attempt to do the exact same thing. And so I really think this is an important place that we need to go.
Thank you. Next question, over here.
Hi there. I'm Rick Casey. I live in Lafayette, Colorado. I teach environmental economics at Front Range Community College part-time. I work as a programmer full-time. And I've been very touched by all the stories of all the panelists. But I've listened with a certain amount of impatience, as I think has been expressed by other questions from the audience here, is that if you want to change the global economy to be more sustainable, you got to change the laws. If you don't change the laws, you're not going to accomplish much. And to change the laws in the long term amounts to changing, I've discovered, changing the jurisprudence, which is sort of a new word to me, which has new meaning. I heard about it long ago, but it never meant much. But jurisprudence means changing the hearts and minds of the judges and the legislators that make their decisions. And I've learned this through bitter experience myself in Lafayette, because in 2013 we passed a law that banned fracking, gave rights to nature, and said that corporations are not people, and 6 months later a Boulder judge ruled against us because state law preempts us still, which shows how the laws need to change. And I'd like to ask the panelists if their opinions about using the power of academia and the entertainment industry to change the jurisprudence around our laws so the laws can start to change.
I can answer one thing about this. It has to do with children, not entertainment so much, but there is a movement among some young people on the West Coast, and it's really international now, I think, to have a legal opinion that the atmosphere is part of the public commons, that the public officials have a fiduciary responsibility to protect the atmosphere on our benefit and for the benefit of future generations. And that's a legally enforceable responsibility. They've been suing all over the country, and in fact all over the world, to try to establish this principle. It seems natural to me that the atmosphere is a thing that we all own, no one individual or country owns, and that people should not be allowed to pollute it. Well, these kids have won a case, or they're in the process of winning a case on the West Coast, and after lots and lots of effort, they finally seem to be breaking through. We'll see where that case goes.
They actually lost, but the governor and the legislature said, we're going to do what it is you want anyway.
And then the governor stopped doing that, and the judge came out and said, Governor, you have to do it. So it's an ongoing battle. What we were proposing to the next president is that he do it administratively, that he say, at the federal level, it is the atmosphere is a public commons as far as we're concerned, and everybody who runs a program that affects the atmosphere has a fiduciary responsibility to protect it. And if you don't, you're not going to get a pay raise. You're not going to get elevated to a higher position. You're going to be downgraded for the job you do.
So I'm part of the United Nations has a movement that just started very recently called something like the Harmony with Nature Initiative. I'm in the branch called Holistic Science, and it's based totally on the notion of Earth jurisprudence. If you go to their website, there's hundreds of essays now there from all over the world, from all different academic disciplines, and it's pretty good. I mean, it's excellent. So the UN is really involved in this move too, based on basically justice for all. Yeah.
Just permit me to tell the story of what happened. When I was heading this ecological company that was making these soaps in this ecological factory, I was paying my workers to ride the bicycle to work, $0.50 a mile. The courts, the tax authorities came after me because they said, you are giving a compensation to the people, they have to be taxed. My argument was, no, they should not be taxed because people driving the car to work have the right to have 50 cents a mile as a compensation for the costs. The court judged against me because those who ride the bicycle do not have costs, therefore it is an income, therefore it's taxed, and I had to pay my fine. I made a huge splash about it. Within 1 year, the law changed. Belgium was the first country in the world, that made riding bike to work a fixed tax deductible amount offered to everyone doing it. You can do it.
Next question, please.
Part suggestion, part question. I believe everyone here knows what a hospital is, what a fire station is, what a courtroom is. What is a climate center? Does such a thing exist? Do we have places that are as ubiquitous in our society? What if we had climate centers as ubiquitous as fire stations, as hospitals, as justice centers, as town halls, places where people could come together and congregate and talk about how do we respond to the flood that just happened? How do we prevent the next one from occurring? Second part of this question, I mean, these centers could, we look in the healthcare industry, we have mobile blood labs and we have mega hospitals. We could have a broad spectrum of climate centers across the United States that could help communicate the story of climate change and help multiple stakeholders and multiple jurisdictions come together to collaborate in a facility that was designed and programmed intentionally to address the issues of climate change. Second part of this I'd like to address to, I believe it's Jim from Chasing Ice. Are you working with virtual reality at all? Stanford and a couple of universities are exploring the possibility of virtual reality to touch people's hearts, to give them a visceral reaction of the implications of climate change so they can experience the glacial melt, the Great Barrier Reef, the Sahara heat waves, and things like that, and they can leave with an experience that says this is real and tangible. It's not an idea. So thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. We do work with VR right now. It's still a very budding technology, and there are different ways that it works, both whether creating a digital world or documenting the real world. It's interesting because it's almost the opposite of film. Instead of being a communal experience where everybody can, you can hear your neighbors laughing or crying, you wear this headset and you go in a corner of the room and you have this isolated experience for 5 minutes and then you take it off, and it's very jarring coming back to the real world. So I have very mixed feelings on it right now, but it's an interesting technology. I'm very curious to see where it's gonna go. But we've done a lot of documentation around the oceans. Our latest film is on ocean change and coral bleaching. And so we've documented a lot of that in VR.
I'll just take the first part of that and just sort of a couple of statistics on there that I think are important. There are very few funders in the world who have recognized the profound links between climate change and health. Health at an individual level, in all sorts of levels. So, you know, 0.01% of NIH budget goes to anything like that, for example, in this country. Although there's very strong evidence linking health to climate, and you know, you can use disasters, you can use heat waves, you can use all sorts of different behavior changes that are linked to changes in climate to make the case that our health depends on our climate. In the private foundations, really only the Wellcome Trust has made a really major move in that direction to really sort of explore how planetary health and human health are fundamentally linked. And the Lancet Commission on this was a big push in that direction, but it's still this nascent bit, and almost all the money goes to zoonotics. Zoonotics is important, but it's not the whole issue. So part of the job, I think, is to actually get out there and advocate for these linkages, to raise them up along all chains, not just in the science, but in the action area. And the health centers, and if health centers are talking about climate, if climate centers are talking about health, this is also to your ideas on polls. I mean, this is the link between climate is always very low on the list for many people's agenda, but their health is not. And so making sure that those links are well known is a huge communication tool that is not necessarily exploited sufficiently at present. It's a really great, I think what you're onto is really strong.
Thank you. In the interest of departing on schedule at 9:30, we're only gonna take one more audience question, and then we'll have a wrap-up question to try and find some resolution, and then leave. So will you please, Madame, pose your question?
I have heard the phrase, how much is enough, a couple times in this conference. And when I have a vision that's a hopeful vision of the future, I see a world with a whole lot less people in it. And I keep hearing root cause, and I keep thinking the root cause of all of it is because there's too many of us. And I don't understand why that isn't talked about anywhere. Why is that?
Because you very quickly get accused of genocide. We know how to solve the population problem. Folk like Dr. Malcolm Potts at University of California, Berkeley School of Public Health have shown if you do five things, and in many cases three of the five, population goes to ZPG or negative population growth. You feed people, so you end hunger, which is one of the UN goals, in fact, I think the first. You reform land tenure so that people who are living on a piece of land but don't have a title to it can get title to it. This then enables them to capitalize themselves, have an address for business, a whole lot of things flow from it. You educate people, particularly women. You provide information on and access to contraception.
In every country where at least three of these things has been done, population goes to ZPG and then starts to decline. So again, this is one of those where we know how to solve the problem in a very benign way. We also know how to feed 10 billion people. We know how to provide energy to at least 9 billion people. We know how to provide a quality of life at roughly the Western European or Italian quality of life. Matthias Wagner-Nackel at Global Footprint Network and I worked through this. We have the technologies to do this, so I'm not sure that we have to grapple with population. But doing the five things that Malcolm suggests are all good things to do anyway, and then population starts to decline. So it all gets easier.
We've also crossed peak child. So we are, this is happening. It was a huge endeavor, and I think it's largely because those five things have been done in many countries that we're now past peak child. We, you know, that tipping point has been crossed.
But you undermine the entire economic system if you start shrinking the population. Just for something to think about.
Yeah, in addition to reading John's paper on regenerative economics, go read his paper on limits to investment. That one is, you know, you end up by saying, well, we need government to do something about it. And I challenged you and said, come on, that's a non-starter. But figuring out almost anything that we do that we know is a good thing to do, we start to crash the economy. So how do we transition this down to a somewhat soft landing? That's a challenge for us all.
Thank you so much. And I want to say that segues perfectly to the last question I wanted to ask. Since 2009, the Wild Foundation's vision has been one of nature needs half. What I like to say, because I'm a little bit more ambitious, nature gets half. And in just this year, we've seen the publication of E.O. Wilson's book, Half Earth, where he's arguing for the same thing. And I think that there can be an interpretation of sustainability that is purely economic and engineering oriented, that is trying to extract efficiencies to make sure that we can maintain the same type of lifestyle or life ways in a similar way in the future. But there are other concepts like this one that bring up the question of sustainability and the idea that we are just one half of a whole. So when we're thinking about half Earth and what it is that we owe each other and also the planet, I guess I want to pose the question to our panelists. Do we owe the planet anything? Do we owe it half of itself? And is this something you feel at all comfortable answering in front of a public audience?
Now, what this lady says is ultimately the final truth. You know, our people, we say Angwan, which means hello, my other self. Because we know that you are my other self, and everybody here is. that we, I like to use a rubber glove, a kitchen rubber glove. You blow it up. These fingers think they're human when they're really one breath. And that's the truth. And we have lost our spirituality in the world. That's why we're in the plight we are today. We have to find it again. And I am hopeful, and so are most of the elders, that we will.
I didn't totally get your question, Amy. There was an echo there. You're saying, do we owe the earth?
Do we owe the earth something? Do we owe it half itself?
Well, first of all, I would say that we're creating stovepipes by the nature of that question, that we are the earth and the earth is us. And I don't mean that metaphysically. It's simply a fact. I think of sustainability as a process of atonement. And there's a couple of meanings there, but if you break it down, it's at-one-ment. But it also means making up for what we've broken and trying to fix it. So I think sustainability, in my mind, at its deepest level, is coming to that process of oneness or that realization of oneness.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I agree. I think you summarized everything that I could imagine saying very beautifully, that the notion of rewilding our hearts is really incorporating all, stakeholders. I can't think of a way to answer nor conceptualize, do we owe the earth half or something like that? We are the earth. I mean, we are all part of earth. And so by looking at everybody involved with this umbrella of oneness, if you will, an umbrella of unity, then really what it turns out to is if we harm others, we harm ourselves. I mean, we are, but we're so far away from that sometimes that we don't really realize that. So thank you.
Are there any other comments?
I think the Anthropocene is a time in which one species has this profound capacity to change the course of an entire planet. And we've never seen that to the extent, certainly we as a species have never seen that. And it raises tremendous questions that we haven't really wrestled with previously. And I think this kind of conversation about what do we want that future to look like are questions that we need to ask ourselves, and ask ourselves probably out in very wild places, not just in coffee shops and not just in universities, but also wild walk, pubs, good place to ask lots of good questions. They can be wild places as well. But I'm also thinking just out in with the other, with the folks that you don't spend as much time with, the non-human folks and those non-human friends, and it's I think important to get that perspective as well, regardless of your spirituality. It's a time where we're going to see such rapid change, and we have more control over that change than we've ever had before. I don't know if control is the right word. More impact on that change than we've ever had before. The challenge is to figure out how to create enough steerage so that we meet a vision that does get, so that we can even answer that question. We can get to a point of understanding how we are a part of this larger whole, how we are valuing ecosystems and what they do, what they give to us, and how we, and maybe it's not even a matter of cutting the pie, but becoming much more integrated within the whole. So I guess that would be my closest answer.
Well, yes, John,
I have a book recommendation, which I don't know why it came to me, but it did, which is called Finite and Infinite Games. And it's about how we're wrapped up in our finite games, and yet there's only one infinite game, which is to continue playing the game. Short little book.
Well,
Amy, can I say something?
Yes, please. That's what you're here to do.
I want to thank you for bringing us together and express my frustration that everybody who wanted to ask a question couldn't. So I've called my wife and asked her if all of you can come over for an after party and continue this talk. She said no, but I do hope we do this again.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much to our panelists.
for being a part of this conversation and to the audience for being here and for asking the questions. There were a lot of other things you could have done tonight, and instead you came to talk about the future of our planet. So thank you very much. Now, let's go out there and keep it wild, folks. Have a good evening.
If you do have this again, I hope that there will be an even balance between men and women.
I'll work on it. That was entirely my fault, Larian. Thank you. Have a good evening, everyone. And enjoy the rest of the conference. I'm so glad we got all that.